Well, hello everybody. A very good evening, and thanks for joining us here with Anand Neelkantan, the man of the moment, and his excellent new book. I hope you guys all get a chance to read it, Chaturanga. So, Anand, thanks so much for joining us here today. I'm really looking forward to our little chat over here.
Thank you. Thank you. We had last chatted for your book of How to Get Published, I think. That was our last chat. That was amazing. That book also was amazing. I wish I had a book like that before I had started publishing.
You won't believe it. I actually wrote How to Get Published because of that. Just because I feel like I wish I'd had a book like that when before I started out. It would have saved me a lot of time and struggle and years of struggle. So, and I remember that excellent. In fact, I remember your essay also that we put it in How to Get Published in India. Anand wrote this amazing essay, and we wrapped up the book with that essay about how to write for TV and films. And I'll come to that as well because I think that was such an excellent point, especially nowadays. I think in the lockdown when writers are struggling a bit and trying to form a find different revenue sources. We'll come to that also very shortly. And guys, by the way, we're open to any questions that you may have. And I'll go to the comment section, see anything that you may have. So please feel free to post anything and we'll take all those questions. So Anand, first, of course, let me start by asking you this very interesting tidbit. I read that this book was inspired by the movie Bahubali. Did I get that right?
No, actually, it is more than that. It is an official prequel of Bahubali. It is not inspired by Bahubali. This is a part of
Acha.
Bahubali films. This is
So what was the journey exactly?
no, it is like the director S.S. Rajamouli had called me to write a prequel to Bahubali. So
Okay.
Bahubali franchise ship was expanding. So there is going to be a Netflix show on this. This is the second book in the series. Third book will be soon coming out. First was Rise of Shivagami, then came Chaturanga. Third will be coming, tentatively named Queen of Mahishmadi, where the book will end, where the film started. So
Amazing.
it is not inspired by this thing. It's a part of that Bahubali universe, the book. So it's a official prequel.
Yeah, exactly. That's amazing. So tell us a bit about the book. It's an excellent book, by the way. I really enjoyed it. I have to confess at this point, I don't read a lot of mythology, but I really enjoyed this book. It was so detailed and so beautifully written, and it captures. And obviously, everybody knows who Anand is, but Anand has always told stories in a very different style. In Asura, he told the story of, I believe, Ramayan from Ravan's perspective. You told in Ajaya, you told the story of Mahabharata from Duryodhan's perspective, and now, of course, you're telling the story of Sivagami, Bahubali's mother, in the position of Bhumipati, and she's out to avenge her father's brutal death. So I think it was so interesting, and I just loved the way you captured her character and the strength from that. So tell me, where did how did the research for that happen, and how did you capture her so well?
No, first thing is creating the story world. So a story like this, which has to become a 50-hour, 60-hour Netflix series or any OTT. At that time, it was not decided Netflix, but now it is Netflix. As a 50, it needs a content of 50 or 60 hours. So it is not planned. It is totally different from my other novels in the sense that other novels is my this thing I am writing for. What I want, what I believe in, and all those things. This is not that I don't believe in it or not, but this is like writing a screenplay. Because this has to become a film, it has to be very, very visual. The kind of readers who are going to read it also, they come from after seeing the great film of Bahubali. So you have to keep presenting that world. So the challenges were different. So more than the research, it was about imagination and fantasy. How you imagine that world? How you go back to the 8th century India, southern India of 8th century, and then the research was based on that. What all could have happened at that time? What would have been the position of the woman? What women in that era? What would have been the position? Was there slavery? We know from the film there was slavery. So the what do you call? You talk about slavery. You talk about caste system. You talk about various problems in that society. And the funny thing is that whatever you write, I keep a principle, it has to be very contemporary. My story might be based on Ramayana period, Mahabharata period, or as I wrote in Vanara, the previous book, it could be set in Kishkindha. or it could be set in Mahishmadi. It has to be contemporary.
Yeah, that makes sense, because you can see that, you know, it's somewhat of a classic where it cuts across all time periods. You know, it doesn't matter when you're reading it or in what time period, also in certain ways that it's set, because it's so strong. The characters and the plot, the characters are so strong, and the plot is so, you know, it's a page turner, the book. I mean, you can't just put it down. And you're saying this, you know, Anand, that I have to say, I read The Rise of Sivagami as well. I mean, that's 500 pages of research and imagination. And I'm just amazed. I mean, it's very impressive the way you've put together so much work into these books, you know, and while you're doing other work as well. But before I move to that as well, Anand, I wanted to ask you, you just mentioned something that caught my interest, that who do you think responds in India most well to your book? You know, I mean, mythology is a big, big, big sell in India, but from your personal experience, where have you seen the most, you know, comments come in? Is it the older demographic? Is it young people? Is it city folks? Is it women or men? Where do you find most of your readers?
Most of my readers, I got two demography actually. I think that represents the reader demography also in India, basically. Below 25 is one huge chunk. 15, I have kids writing from kids from the age of 11 writing to me. Though my books are not meant for kids. One book is coming for kids next month. That's separate. But otherwise, which I'm writing. But otherwise, my books are all deal with not kids stuff. So I have one chunk above 25 and another chunk above 50. Okay. I think that is the reader's age also. I think rather people in our age group are between 25 and 50 age group people are so caught up in life, not many are reading it. Not only my book, generally all other books. So naturally, whatever I am getting is from either of these two age groups, senior citizen or youth, not the, if you call that, the middle-aged one, 25 to 50 age. 25 is not middle age, but entering the working age, you know, then your career is going, taking off, you are busy with that. Those people are reading comparatively lesser, and I have discussed with other authors also. You might have experienced it perhaps.
Of course.
It might be coming from either of these. They, of course, author to author it may change, but most of the mythology authors are from these two groups.
Okay. That's great. One thing that also caught my interest, you know, was that in the acknowledgements you thanked your sister Chandrika. And, you know, I want to understand that you are a male writer writing, you know, a very strong female protagonist. So obviously the first question that beckons to be asked is that who are the influential women in your own life? You know, you mentioned Chandrika, of course, but has there been some very strong female role model for you that inspired you to write such strong female characters?
I was brought up by my sister, so that's why I dedicated the book to her, Chandrika. So, and my mother also was a strong figure, but I grew up in my sister, I have a gap of 19 years almost, 18 years gap with my 18
elder years?
Sister. 18 years. So I might have been a product of accident, perhaps, if I may call that.
Those are the best accidents. Okay.
So I was brought up, so she is like a mother figure to me, and she was quite an influence. Then of course my wife Aparna is a big influence, and now my daughter also. They are all big critics, so they don't take me seriously. That's a good thing.
That's good to know. And in mythology, who have you found to be your female role models?
Female role models, I have always maintained the strongest female role model in Indian Puranas is Sita, not Draupadi. After Sita, I will say Tara. But most, what do you call it, the most strongest role model I have found Sita, and not the Sita of traditional Ramayana. The traditional sense, not the Sita of television Ramayana or even Bhaktiara Ramayana. I'm talking about Valmiki Ramayana. Sita is a totally different character. Usual Sita what we know. That has been changed by the Bhaktiara poets.
Okay. So not the usual. But why do you say that? Like, sorry, I'm trying to get to the comments because it seemed to have frozen on my page. Okay, now I can see this. Yeah. So why do you say the Sita not of the traditional Ramayana?
The traditional means what? Basically, now what we call as Sita is the creation of Tulasidas. son Tulasidas. Tulasidas ji had created a Sita based on every era writes its own Ramayana. So Tulasidas ji's Ramayana Sita is a product of the Mughal era.
Okay.
So there is a lot of influence of that era in creation of that Sita. Whereas Valmiki Sita or Sita in many other other regional Ramayanas, I won't call some regional, other Indian classical language Ramayanas, Sita is very different. She is not the product of that Mughal society. So there the Sita doesn't, Sita is not the demure woman. She is very strong. Valmiki Sita is very, very, very strong. Everything she does through her choice. She doesn't, it is not that she is an Adarsha Nari, whatever her husband says, she does. It's absolutely not. If you actually read the plot line, it is not that even in Tulsidas ji's Ramayana also. It is because of the other comments which has been put, it became like that. Otherwise, see Valmiki's Sita, when Ram asks her to stay at home, when he wants to go to the forest, she says, no, I will accompany you. She is adamant.
Yeah.
She convinces him that he has to come with her. With him, because it is her choice. Then when she goes to when she is in the ashram in the vanvas, when Ravan comes, it is her choice to give him Bhiksha. Even though she has warned, not in Valmiki Ramayana Lakshman Rekha is not there, but even if you take Lakshman Rekha, she is the one who crosses it. She doesn't she is not, so she actually goes out of whatever male has pulled, and she takes the choice, saying that a hungry man should not go hungry. It's my choice. She goes, and then she gets kidnapped by Ravan. Then Hanuman comes there. Hanuman says, I can take you back. Again, it is her choice. She says, I will not come. It is for Ram to come and take me out. Then when the choice of hungry Bariksha comes, it is her choice to enter the fire. It's not Ram. Ram says, I don't want you. You can go. It's actually like that. The kind of harsh words Ram use in Valmiki Ramayana, it will be shocking for someone if you read it now. To Sita, after winning Ravan. Then Sita, it is Sita's choice to enter the Agni Pariksha.
After that,
when she is abandoned again by Ram, it is her choice to bring up her kids, and what would be a better revenge, as she is the first, perhaps one of the first single mother. There are other characters in Purana, I'm not ignoring that, but she is the first single mother, if you really see in that sense of the word. She brings up as the two kids, she teaches them everything a king has to know, and they defeat the entire army of Ram, including Hanuman, everybody they defeat. What could be a better revenge, if you see? What could be a sweeter revenge? Compare it with the revenge of Draupadi, where everyone dies, including her own kids. Whereas how positive Sita's revenge is. She has made a spectacular statement that I will need a male to bring up my kids and to bring them up. Then after that, when Ram asks for Agni Pariksha again, this time it is her choice that I will not subject myself to this humiliation, and she goes down to her womb of mother. So here we are fine. There is no other character in our Purana who goes exactly by their choices and not by the dictates of the society. She is totally, if you compare it, she is in total contrast with Ram, who goes with the dictates of the society. Whereas Sita is a perpetual rebel. She is more rebellious than any other character. And her rebellion is for a purpose.
That is why I never
thought about it that way. You know, what has happened is, including television serials, so I tried to change it through my serial in CRK Ram, which I wrote the script. So I was telling Sita through, but television is television. Beyond that, you cannot move. Beyond a limit, you cannot move. In a book, you can explore. So Sita has been portrayed like this from the Bhakti era, 16th century onwards, especially in the Gangetic plains. Whereas we coming from the coastal areas, southern coastal areas or eastern areas, Sita is totally different. Even in Bengal, Sita is different. Orissa, Sita is different. South, Sita is different. But what now captured is Ramanand Sagarji's Ramayana, which more or less followed the Tulsidas's Ramayana, which is a product of Mughal era. So beautiful poetry, great work of art, that and all are separate. And talking about one single point, the way in which women are portrayed is totally different from what is portrayed in other Ramayanas of India. That's all I think.
Definitely. That's very interesting. Okay. But one thing I don't know how many people notice about Anand that he's almost a chameleon when it comes to writing, because you have really adapted to all kinds of mediums when it comes to writing, whether it's from writing novels to writing for television and now films. First of all, let me ask you, Anand, what has it been like, during COVID for you personally as an author, as a writer, and as someone who's come out with such a big book? How different has that experience been from, say last year when all of us were launching our books with huge sort of physical platforms? So what's the biggest shift you've seen?
These are tough times for everyone, but we had to keep our job going. Lot of like if you see Asura and all were sold maximum from Crossword. Crossword is the one which, if you ask me, which launched my career as such. Now many of the shops due to the COVID situation is closed, and we have to depend wherever it is opened, and then through the online world. World is changing; you have to adapt to that. Everybody will have to come to online platform now. There is no other way. Even this talk we are doing, we would have done it in some cozy bookshop somewhere. Instead, we are now sitting at our home and doing it. It is a tough situation. It is a lot of people have lost their jobs. Lot of it is not anybody's fault because what do you call COVID is not something is planned. These things happen, but humanity keeps on going through this kind of crisis. If you read history, you find that every 30 years, 40 years, this kind of calamity comes. Imagine you are living 70 years back, you'll be in the mid of a world war. And then if you are in India, you are northern India, you are in the mid of a partition. Or if you are in Bengal, 75 years ago, you are in the mid of the world's greatest famine at that time. For almost 35 lakh people died of famine without food. So every era throws up this kind of challenge. Humanity has come forward going over that. So I don't think book world will be immune to that, or the bookshops will be immune to what is happening around. So we'll have to cope up with it. We'll have to adjust with it. It's a total shake-up. Lot of shooting, everything is stopped in the television or other industry. So everybody is going through a crisis. But for writers, we can sit and write. That way, we are fortunate. Only thing is that we should find readers also.
But do you think this is a good time? Because a lot of writers are asking this also, I'm going to quickly just go through some of the comments. Somebody, Anand, is appreciating your background. I was asking Anand the same thing. I said, what a dynamic and striking background. So somebody's appreciating this and saying, I love the background. You guys have any questions, please feel free to ask. Somebody's asked about what to do if companies fire their employees in during COVID. But I think that's a little bit off track. So let me just ask the next question I wanted to, about your TV writing career, Anand. So, right now a lot of writers are struggling, but still a lot of content is being consumed, especially in OTT platforms. So is this a good time to become a TV writer to write for, say, movies or web series or television also?
This is the time to again, like it's an unfair world. If you are already established, then you will get a lot of work. This is a time you can sit and write, thinking that we will be able to come back to normal by next year. So you prepare all the way. So I am writing a lot. But if you are a newcomer, nobody will experiment now, to be very frank. And if you are an actor or something, only for the back end will work. No. If you are a writer, you are an and if you are an editor or something like that, whatever has been done earlier before the thing, that work until then for some more months they will have work. After that, until the new thing comes, if this continues, it's going to be tough. Why? Because we are thinking, say, in another 3 months, 4 months, things will be normal. So you are writing, preparing for that. But if it doesn't become normal in 4 months, again, it's going to be tough. But this is the time for novel writers, not TV writers, because novel writers, they are not dependent on, book writers are not dependent on other people. If you are writing for TV, if you are writing for TV, you are dependent on so many things. There has to be a producer to back you. There has to be a director to take it. There has to be actors. Shooting has to happen. There are 2,000, 3,000 people working on it for any script you write. The TV or in the films. Whereas novel, it's your world. You create your world. This is the time to polish. This is the time, if you have written something, this is the time to go for the 7th draft, 8th draft, 10th draft of the book.
Yeah.
Polish it again. Many newcoming writers I have seen, they never go for the 2nd or 3rd draft. They finish the 1st draft and try to get it published, get rejection, they will have depression, then they stop writing. disheartened and they stop writing
and they're like, we'll never write again, and which is sad. I always tell people that you have to, I think, edit. Basically, writing is rewriting, so editing is very important in that perspective.
See, writing is one profession you need the least amount of capital. Any other profession, you need a lot of capital. Even if you are an artist, a painter, you need a lot of capital. Painting, I occasionally do painting, it's so expensive. Writing you can do with a 3 rupee pen and a paper, 50 paisa paper.
That's true.
You can use fancy software and all, that's for a later stage. But everybody can start writing with a one paper and a this thing. So it's one of the the cheapest, least capital oriented profession in the world. And this, when you have time, and one thing, no, any other profession, if you are depressed, you cannot do anything. You have lost your job, you cannot do anything. Writing is one thing, the more depressed you are, the better you write, perhaps.
I think, yeah, the more depressed you are, the better your writing becomes, actually.
Because you can, it's a relief. You can pour out your anger against the system, against the employee who fired you, or against the business client who fired you, or against the COVID. Writing is about emotion. So you are in an emotional state now. This is the time to write. I'm not telling it in a this thing, because most of the great works in the literature has been written in this kind of stage, where many people were going, the world was going through a churn. You are losing an opportunity if you are not using this to write. This is the time to write.
So have you been writing a lot also during the lockdown? Have you made the most of the
I have been writing a lot. One thing was, I had a lot of things signed up for that. I, being the professional writer, I had to write to buy idli and dosha for me. I don't eat bread, so I'm not using that. From me, put idli and dosha into my table. I need to write. So I've been writing. I have written this third part of the book. 90% is over. And apart from that, one audible original I am writing. That's also over. That's also will be coming soon. Then one children's book is coming. And another two books on first draft I am over with. Another two books. One film I have finished, which announcement will come soon. The screenplay I have finished. Then two, three pictures has been pitch documents and stories for OTT platforms. That also I have finished, and they also have been accepted. So last 4 or 5 months, it has been very prolific. I've been writing a lot.
That's good. That's good to hear. And what about TV writing? You know, because a lot of people are saying right now that the most money that a writer can make, you know, so that they can stop wearing a jhola and start wearing Armani, is right now through films or web series or TV, like serials. So do you agree with that?
TV is tough.
It's tough,
Anything is tough. Anything that pays you good money is tough. There is no easy money in the world.
Yeah.
So TV, you don't get much of a satisfaction having done. OTT platform is different. OTT platform is writing more like a novel, and you have got a bigger canvas. TV is like deadline. I don't write general TV now. I have quit general TV. Almost 500 episodes, 500 hours of content I had created in the last 4 or 5 years. But last 1.5-2 years, I'm not writing TV. I have moved 500 episodes of all the 3 hit serials I had written. No, Siya Ke Ram, Chakravarti Ashoka, Mahabali Hanuman, and few episodes of Adalat too. But general TV, I quit in the sense it's taking too much toll. I'm a lazy person. I don't want to work like that. So I shifted to, I always keep writing books. But it's better to move into OTT platform or films if possible. So as you grow in your career, you will slowly move away from. I don't want to get stuck in TV. Not that I will never write it, but only if it is challenging enough. not the general stuff.
So but right OTT, now, most positive is the other OTT platforms, you would say, to anybody who's aspiring to
write. The OTT platform, again, there is a winner bias in every field. You succeed in it, then you keep getting work. Otherwise, breaking it into it is a matter of luck and a matter of skill and a lot of hard work. So, reaching, the problem with the OTT or films and all, somebody will have to put a lot of money into producing it. And it runs into 100 crores, 200 crores, 300 crores. So people will have to believe in your writing to put that, because that is the foundation. Your writing is the foundation of it. So it has to satisfy a lot of other things. It has, see, you may write beautifully for a book. Absolute, stunning prose, poetic. But this might not transfer itself to a visual media, because these are all different mediums. So some people's writing transfer it to a better to a visual media. Some are better heard as a poetry. It's very poetic to talk, to hear it. Some are about beautiful language. So they will, it's like how they, that's why you find that rarely many of the award-winning books gets converted well to films. Or even otherwise, good books also will not get converted to films. Films or the visual media is a different thing. It is not easy to convert. It's not one-to-one conversion. So, what do you call, it's not, when you are talking about, I'll shift to TV. It is like learning from the foundation. It's not that a good novelist can write a TV show or vice versa. So, it's like a, it's a lot of shift in your gear. So, it's a lot of hard work to learn it. Not many people have done that. I'm not telling it because I have done it, but not many people have done that because it involves a lot of people management also, not only writing skills. Many people fail in that because when you are writing a novel, you are the king, you and your editor. No one else will tell a word. Okay, you choose your word. And with films, TV, films, any visual media, it's an industry. It is not a, it's not just art. And you are just one part of it. You are just a cog of it. You are not the main, you are not the hero. In a novel, you are the hero. In a short story, you are the hero. The writer is the hero. You decide what you want. But there you write anything, it will be subject to budgetary constraint. It will be subject to the actor's antics. If I may call that, or actors, they will have a point also sometimes because they have been in the industry for so long. They know what works better than the writer. If you're a newcoming writer, so they have to be respected. Editor will take a call. Director will take a call. Producer will take a call. If you're writing for channel, channel executives will take a call. So there will be a lot of interference. That's what I said. It's more about people management also. So if you are comfortable, if you are a artistic artist, it is better to stick to book writing. Even in book writing, it's all different kind of writing. If you are a poet, that's separate. If you are a poetic prose writer, that is separate. And you are a potboiler writer, that's also a separate skill. Nothing is superior or inferior to another. It's all what you choose. Somebody has asked, what do you think? Pardon?
So somebody's asked if there's a tectonic shift in TV content creation.
There will be, there will be, even TV content will have to be changed, keeping in mind the social distancing now. Even if limited way shooting is happening, you have to keep in your mind how to write the script. You cannot think about a massive scene, mounted up scene with so many people working, because whoever have attempted, whoever have challenged this COVID, have got it. That's the truth as of now. Because virus doesn't discriminate. Virus doesn't think whether you are a great writer or a director or an actor or a politician or the prime minister or the president or whatever, the king. So everything, not only TV content creation, everything is subject to the present normal. So even when you are writing it, all these things, and when the problem with this, all these things, if you are a new writer, you write it accordingly. By the time you finish it, the situation would have changed.
How do you?
So that is why, So that is why you should not write. You have to write what you like. Maybe its time has not come now.
Yeah.
But the time will, it's cyclic. Time will come anytime. So you have to wait for that. So if you are itching to write, better to stick to novels now and not come to try for TV and films. It's a step-by-step process. As I said, novel you can control.
Yeah.
You can control the script. The other thing, there is no control for your script.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, Anand, I'll wrap up with my final question. And then if anybody has any more questions, please feel free to ask them. It's your last chance. You know, I remember very distinctly that in the first time we'd met, correct me if I'm wrong, it was on stage at a literature festival a few years ago. And you had said something very interesting that, you know, I don't know why we were talking about the hegemony of English, you know, that most of the books at that time were written in English and read by primarily English readers. And you had made a very interesting point where you said that an author does not have to have a good command of, say, English in order to write good books. And that time it seemed like such a hatke idea. But now when I'm seeing, you know, so many translated works and seeing so many beautiful stories come out from literally the nooks and crannies of India, you know, and I think we need more such stories to become more mainstream, to become bestsellers. So I think that was a very interesting, you know, point that you had made. I think you saw literally ahead of your time in many ways. So have you seen even right now with the last couple of years a transformation and good, more sort of regional literature coming into the mainstream eye?
It is very wrong to call them regional literatures. They are not regional literatures. Indian languages, all the Indian languages have a history much, what do you call, deeper and longer history than English. English that way is not a, what do you call, not that rich language, if I may put it. Only because of the colonialism we are speaking in English now. And it is good to communicate in English. That's the best link language we are having. There's no doubt about that. Everyone can, it's a neutral language, so everyone can learn English and tell it. It's not somebody's mother tongue which and others will have to learn. English is neutral for entire Indian population, so that's why it remains as a communication language, and that's why we are now also speaking in English. But the problem is, in a language is deeply bound to the culture, the weather, the people, everything. English that way is very alien, if you think like that. It can be only used as a communication tool. So that is why when you are writing, why, as I said, one example, if you say, they adore hot climate. English, everything good is hot. Everything good is fair. Okay. But how does Indians take it? For us, rain is romantic. For them, rain is wretched. So how will you communicate a beautiful mega sandesha into English? Because the entire concept has changed. We live in a tropical country where for us rain is so romantic. Rain is not a wretched time for us unless there is flood. So not only that, everything, no, it's a warm welcome. Warm welcome, if you translate to Indian language, it's like you are angry, isn't it? Here you have to traditional Indian language is a, it's a cold welcome, even though in English it sounds cold. But if you think it in your native language, it is like when somebody comes, you are giving them cold drink, lassi or everything cold, or even water, cold water is what you give in the matke kapani, you are giving that. It is never a hot this thing. So everything changes. Your language, because of the weather, because of the this thing, everything changes. White, the color also, no? So it also changes as per the this thing. They wear white. For us, white is a different. White also changes from parts of India to another. In Kerala and all, white is an auspicious color. In many other parts of the country, white is a widow's color. So how will you translate this? When you write, no, what is the color of grief when you are writing? Is it black or white? It changes from widow's black. The Europeans wear widow's black. In English, you say widow's black. She is wearing the widow's black. In India, you wear, the widows wear white. So suddenly, the color of grief itself changes. I'm just telling it as example.
That's true.
So English is not a language to communicate what Indians think. So you can use it only as a tool to create a visual thing. in the mind. That's what I try to do with my book. So many a times you struggle with the words. What is a hack word? Otherwise, it will sound alien, because then I should have, in when I write novel, I should have in my mind, who is going to read the book? Am I writing it for an foreign audience where I have to write Dharma and put an asterisk and explain three, some stupid explanation to that? Or if I just use a Sanskrit word or a Tamil word or a Hindi word or a Malayalam word, people will easily understand it by the context. So when I consider my reading is going to be Indian, I don't care if they want to read, because I don't see an Englishman or an American writing with Indians in their mind. They write it as per their culture and we go and suck it up. That is, so when I am writing, I decided that I will not write for awards for any, in the sense, I will not write for the Europeans or Americans. I am writing for my people. So even if it is breaking in the English language, the rules of English language, it doesn't mind, because I think people like us are creating a new language here, that is Indian English. It is neither the Queen's English nor the American English. This is a language which has a history of 250 years in India, that is Indian English, a 250 year old language. It will have its own grammar in another 50 years. How Australian English diversified or African English diversified, Indian English will have its own, now itself it has happened like that. So we are all the pioneers in that. So we are creating our own language, which will have a lot of Hindi words, Sanskrit word, Malayalam word, Tamil word, Bengali words in that. So it's not going to be the Queen's English or King's English. We'll break the grammar rules, because we don't care. It's not our language. Why should we care?
I hope all the aspiring writers are listening to this, because it's very interesting. I think we're being told now to log off. We've overshot our time.
Okay.
But thank you guys so much for joining us here today. Thank you, Anand. This was so great. And in case you haven't, guys, please do pick up both these beautiful books. You know, I've had an absolute delightful time reading both of them. And Anand's writing is very strong. It's you know, it's very unexpected, and the pace, it's like a thriller. It's really beautiful. And before I go, Anand, one last question. You know, Bahubali is mentioned here. What was your experience like with Rajamouli? I mean, how did the whole interaction go? I think just a behind. No,
he had read my Asura, Ajay, and all, and had liked my style of writing, because he said it is very visual.
Yeah.
So visual, there are different kind of writings. No, not one is superior or inferior, but my writing in a book also renders more to visual, because as I said, I don't know English much. I learned English very late. So English is not my strong point. Language is not my strong point. My strong point is how I imagine my visualization. So he liked the visualization more, because he's a visual person. No, otherwise he would have written books. He tells beautiful stories in the films. So you said your writing is more like it's coming alive as a film, rather than coming beautiful like a song, like a poetry. That's another way of writing. No, a lot of great writers write poetically. So this is a visual kind of writing, because it's not my language. So he gave me full freedom. He said you can choose whichever character you want and write a backstory. So from there, it's an official prequel where it is 30 years back I went and wrote about the book. So almost 40 characters I created. I went to a story world. My attempt is to take the readers to the 8th century India, medieval India. And
amazing. That's really phenomenal. That's really phenomenal. Wow. And this is going to be made by Rajamouli itself, or will there be somebody
else? Their team. He might not be doing it directly. Their team, the same producer. And
amazing. Fantastic. I can't wait to watch it also on the big screen. And if you guys want to pick up your copy of both these fantastic books, please go to the Crossword website. They put the links up on this chat. I think we're out of time completely. But again, thank you, Anand. It was lovely talking as usual. Please stay safe.
Thank you.
And look forward to reading many, many more interesting works that you're coming up with during this lockdown. Look forward to it. Take care.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bye, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. And have a lovely evening and stay safe.